you're joining us online or whether you're here in the sanctuary, we are glad that you have chosen today that we might be in God's house as we gather together as God's people. If you're joining us virtually, we're going to share in Holy Communion later in our service. And so if you have bread or juice, I want to encourage you to get those and have them ready as we're going to share together in the Holy Communion. Hopefully you had a chance to look through some of those slides that were on the screen this morning. Some of the announcements about upcoming things happening in the life of the church. Also, I failed to mention this last week, but we got a new sound system, so we're trying to figure all that out. We also have new people running our media. We also have new media programs, so lots of new stuff going on, so lots of grace should abound for all of us as we're learning and trying to figure all this new stuff out, as well as all the things that it takes to go virtual and be in person at the same time. But we're glad you're here this morning, and I'm going to invite you to stand as you're able, and let's join us in our open together.
Come on. remember we talked about Hannah. Hannah was a fierce woman because she kept her promises. Deborah, we talked about last week, was a fierce woman because she listened to what God told her to do. Today, we're going to talk about this third woman, and her name is Esther. Do you know why Esther was the first fierce woman? She was a fierce woman because she was so brave. Well, the story about Esther is kind of like a Cinderella story. They were trying to find a new queen for the king, and they gathered up a bunch of girls to go meet him. Well, the king saw Esther and fell in love with her. Well, he didn't know she was a Jew. It was kind of a secret. So another guy got mad at a guy who was a Jew and decided to convince the king to kill all the Jews. And the king, not knowing any better, went along with it. Well, back in the day, you know, girls couldn't just run up and go tell the king whatever they wanted. You know, you had to be invited to talk to him. Well, Esther was so nervous and so scared that she could get killed just by going to tell the king, hey, don't kill the Jews, it's a bad idea. But you know what? Because they were her people, she was so brave and went and talked to the king anyway and said, hey, these are my people and they don't deserve that. And the king listened to her and saved her people, right? That is pretty awesome and that is pretty great. She would save her people even though it could cost her her life. That's pretty cool, right? So, I want you guys to remember, stay brave. Whenever things are a little scary or you're not sure, stay brave. Because God's always by your side, right? Let's go ahead and say a prayer together. Are you ready? Close your eyes. Dear God.
Dear God.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For keeping us brave.
For keeping us brave.
In times when we're unsure.
In times when we're unsure.
Or scared.
Or scared.
Thank you for your love.
Thank you for your love.
Amen. Amen, guys. Thank you. I'll see you next week.
Come to a time when we normally would offer up our offerings and tithes this morning. For those of you that may have an offering with you, there is a box at the door that you can leave it as you leave. But if you would, please join me in prayer. Our gracious Heavenly Father, giver of all gifts, once again we come to this time of the service when we offer up our tithes and our gifts back to you to be used in spreading your word throughout this world. This hurting world. These things we ask in your mighty and precious name. Amen.
Sing a new song.
We come to a time of prayer this morning. We want to think about all of those that we may have on our hearts. And for just a moment of silence, let's lift each one of those up that we are praying for, that we are thankful for. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Gracious Heavenly Father, we know you by many names. We know you as the great comforter, the great healer, and the great physician. And there are so many that are in need of your healing hands this day. We especially lift up to you our President, our First Lady, and all of those others who are members of our government in Washington. We pray for their recovery. We pray that this will be a time of unity and not division. We simply ask for your healing, not only on them, but on our country. We want to remember all of those that are far away from home, foreign lands, defending our country. We ask that you be with them, protect them, be with their families in this time of separation. So many of us here already know that feeling. We lift up to you our church as we all slowly begin to worship in person. We thank you for that opportunity. We lift up our pastor and the administration of our church that they will continue to guide us in the right paths. We ask all these things in your mighty and precious name, in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
So we finish up our sermon series today. We're going to be in the book of Esther. In the fourth chapter, we're going to read just a section of it. I'm going to share more of Esther's story with you during the message. So listen for God's word as it comes to you this day. When Mordecai learned all that had been done, Mordecai tore his clothes and put on sackcloth and ashes and went out into the midst of the city. And he cried out with a loud and bitter cry. He went up to the entrance of the king's gate, for no one was allowed to enter the king's gate clothed in sackcloth. And in every province where the king's command and his decree reached, there was a great mourning among the Jews, with fasting and weeping and lamenting, and many of them lay in sackcloth and ashes. When Esther's young women and her eunuchs came and told her, the queen was deeply distressed. She sent garments to clothe Mordecai so that he might take off his sackcloth, but he would not accept them. Then Esther called for Hathach, one of the king's eunuchs who had been appointed to attend her, and ordered him to go to Mordecai to learn what this was and why it was. Went to Mordecai in the open square of the city in front of the king's gate, and Mordecai told him all that had happened to him and the exact sum of money that Haman had promised to pay to the king's treasuries for the destruction of the Jews. And Mordecai also gave him a copy of the written decree issued in Susa for their destruction, that he might show it to Esther and explain to her and command her to go to the king to beg his favor and plead with him on behalf of the people. Hathach went and told Esther that Mordecai had said, and then Esther spoke to Hathach and commanded him to go to Mordecai and say, all the king's servants and all the people of the king's provinces know that if any man or woman goes to the king inside the inner court without being called, there is but one law, to be put to death, except the one to whom the king holds out the golden scepter so that he may live. But But as for me, I have not been called to come into the king these 30 days. And they told Mordecai what Esther had said. And then Mordecai told them to reply to Esther, "Do not think of yourself that in the king's palace you will escape any more than all the other Jews. For if you keep silent at this time, relief and deliverance will arise for the Jews from another place. But you and your father's house will perish. And who knows whether you have not come to the kingdom for such a time as this." And then Esther told them to reply to Mordecai, "Go gather all the Jews who you found in Susa and hold fast on my behalf. And do not eat or drink for 3 days, night or day. I and my young women will also fast as you do. And I will go to the king, though it is against the law. And if I perish, I perish." And Mordecai then went away and did everything as Esther had ordered him. This is the word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Let's pray together. God, we thank you for powerful witnesses. We thank you for important stories. We thank you, God, for your holy word, which comes and speaks a powerful and mighty truth to us. So I pray, God, either through me or in spite of me, speak your word to your people. And we ask it in the name of Christ our Savior. Amen. I was having a coaching call with my mentor a couple of weeks ago. He asked me a really interesting question. Here's what he said. "What's the most important thing that you have learned in the midst of a pandemic?" It's an interesting question, isn't it? If you think about it, I don't know what comes to your mind, but I had to get an answer pretty fast. Jerry didn't want me to think too long about it. So I said quickly, "There are lessons everywhere if we are looking." And he said, "Tell me more about what you mean." I said, "Well, I've learned lessons from lots of people. Everything from a tiny little baby who, if you've seen that on YouTube, where just laughs and laughs and laughs at everything. Or you learn maybe from an older person. I love that older grandfather who came and danced in the street with his grandfather and wanted to spend time with him. Socially distanced time. I've learned things from my own family, my children. I've learned things from God's creation about what it looks like to be still and quiet in the presence of God. I've learned all kinds of things. And the lessons have all been there, I think, all along. It's just that I was so busy doing life that I missed God's lessons of life and faith that were around me all the time." That's one of the reasons I've so enjoyed preaching this sermon series that we've been in. I've never preached a series on women in the Bible, but I have learned a tremendous amount about who these women were and what they give to us. Ruth has taught us what it looks like to be a person of valor for God. Hannah has taught me what it looks like to live in faith, deep, abiding faith, and how to fervently pray for something. I learned from Deborah that God can use any of us for a very special purpose if we are available to Him. And today we're going to learn something from a lesson for us from Esther. Now, the book of Esther is an interesting book. It takes place almost 2,500 years ago in a city called Susa. If you're geographically challenged, it's north of the Persian Gulf, east of the Tigris and Euphrates. It would be what you and I would know as modern-day Iran. So now, what has happened is the Israelites have been in captivity under the Babylonians for 70 years. One whole generation has known nothing but living in Persia and being ruled by the Babylonians. Now, after the Babylonians get defeated by Persia and King Cyrus be, they began to be, to the process to rebuild the city and to rebuild the temple. And the story of Esther actually takes place in 10 years that occurs between the first wave of people returning to Israel and the second wave. Now, not all the Jews want to go back to Judah. Some of them wanted to stay in the Persian Empire. Life is hard in Jerusalem. Life is good where they're living now. The Persian Empire was the most dominant economic and military power of its time. It was magnificent cities were built in Persia. The culture of Persia was one of the most advanced of its day. It had an incredible legal system. It had a modern postal system. The wealth was flowing, and the Jews were reaping the benefits of that. Many of them, we know, had great wealth because they're sending incredible things back to Israel, to the Israelites there. They also had increasing power in the Persian Empire, because we know that, because look at Esther's influence on what happened in there. And so the Jews who stayed behind had an opportunity also, not only to live a good life, but they had an opportunity to witness to the one true God, the God of Isaac and Jacob, the God they worshipped. Now, so let's think about the life lessons that Esther teaches us. The first one is that Esther took advantage of the opportunity that's placed before her. Now, Erwin McManus wrote an awesome book called Seizing Your Divine Moments. I want you to hear what he says. What if you knew somewhere in front of you was a moment that would change your life forever? A moment rich with potential. A moment filled with endless possibilities. What if you knew there was a moment coming, a divine moment, one where God would meet you in such a way that nothing would ever be the same again? What if there was a moment, a defining moment, where the choices you make determine the course and momentum of your future? How would you treat that moment? How would you prepare for it? How would you identify it? Moments are as numerous as the stars in the sky and the sands in the sea. Any one of them could prove to be your most significant divine moment. However mundane a moment may appear, the miraculous may wait to be unwrapped within you. You rarely know the eternal significance of a moment. When a moment is missed, you have a glimpse of an opportunity lost. When you dream, you look to a moment still to come. Yet the only moment that you must take responsibility for is right now in front of you. There may well be many moments waiting behind this one. And though the most significant moments of your life may still be moments away, the moment you are in right now is waiting to be seized. Esther seized her divine moment. She knew about God's timing and God's placement, and she knew this opportunity that lay in front of her, that God had blessed her with a moment. It happened like this. Let me give you the story that leads up to what we read today. King Xerxes, he's in the third year of his reign. He's reigning, it's about 486 BC, if you want to place into a time frame. And he was very focused on money and power. Sounds familiar, right? It was kings, they get into that. He had a violent temper. He often acted without thinking. The book of Esther begins with Xerxes holding a grand festival. Now, not just any kind of festival. This festival lasted 6 months, and it was designed to show everybody how much power and wealth he had in his kingdom. And at the conclusion, he held a 7-day feast. Can you imagine just eating for 7 days? Everything filled with food and drink, all the best. And by the 7th day, everyone was feeling a little bit nauseous and a lot drunk, a lot too much to drink. And so the king calls for his beautiful queen, a woman named Vashti, to come and to sort of parade in front of the guests. Now, she's a little offended by this request, and so she promptly tells him, "No, I'm not going to do that." Now, in those days, if a command came from the king and you said no, you know what that might happen. right? Off of your head. But for some reason, Xerxes decides that he'll just simply make a decree that she will never appear in front of him ever again. And he sends her away. And so at that point, the counselors say, hey, you know what you should do instead? You should have a beauty pageant. And so they have a beauty pageant. And the story is that 400 virgins come to live in the palace for an entire year. That's a long beauty contest, isn't it? Now, hearing that they're looking for beautiful women, Mordecai knows he has this cousin named Esther, and she's beautiful. And so he has a friend who works inside the king's court, a man named Peggy, and he goes to him and he says, you gotta be Esther, because I think Esther's your girl. And so he is immediately taken with Esther. He thinks Esther's beautiful. He gives her 7 maidens to take care of her. He gives her all the best perfumes and ointments, and she's living in the palace during this whole year. And when she comes before the king, King Xerxes is like, yes, Esther is the one I want. So he decides that she will become the queen of Persia. No one mentions that she's a Jew. Nobody knows that, but she knows it, and Mordecai knows it, but nobody else knows it. So hold that thought. So Esther is now the new queen, but there's another story that's occurring at the same time. About a man named Haman, who is promoted to be the head of all the princes right underneath the king. And Haman's promotion kind of goes straight to his head. He begins to think a little bit too highly of himself. And the king commands that everyone who comes in contact with Haman should bow down before him. Well, Mordecai, he's not bowing down to Haman. And every time Haman encounters Mordecai, it makes Haman more and more angry that Mordecai won't bow down to him. And so Haman hates Mordecai because Haman is an Amalekite and Mordecai's a Jew, and those two groups of people hate each other. And so he decides he's got to get rid of these Jews. So he goes to the king and he says, we shouldn't just get rid of Mordecai, we should get rid of all the Jews. And he convinces the king this is a really good idea. So the king makes a decree that all the Jews will die. Now Mordecai learns about Haman's little plot. He tears his clothes, remember? He puts on sackcloth and ashes. Imagine wearing a burlap suit and goes standing out in front of the king's court. And this is as close as he can get to Esther because he can't go any further. And then the king's decree spreads all over and the Jews begin to weep and to fast and to pray. Esther's servants bring word to her about her cousin, and she sends new clothes up to her. Take off the burlap suit and put on the new clothes. But Mordecai won't receive those. And he instructs Esther that she has to use her position and her influence over the king on behalf of her people. Mordecai also warns Esther that even she will not keep him, she will not be saved from Haman. Mordecai's faith, however, never wavers. And he tells Esther that if deliverance for the Jews does not come through her, it will come through someone else. That God's plan will not be thwarted. But she has an opportunity to participate in the salvation of God's people. And if she doesn't, she will miss out on a divine opportunity. She understands that she's been given a time and a place and an opportunity to be a witness to the one true God that she worships. And Esther seizes the moment. And she says, if I perish, then I will perish. But essentially she's saying, if I die, I will die doing what God has called me to do. The second thing we learn from Esther is this. Esther seeks out God first. Through prayer and fasting, she seeks God's will in the midst of begin to fast and pray for 3 days. All the Jews do that with me, and all those in my court will do it too. We're going to face this problem head on. We're going to go to God in prayer and fasting. Let me ask you a question. When life deals you a tough blow, is that where you turn first? Because I think a lot of us do this. We turn to our friends, or our family, or our spouse, or our co-workers. Why is it that so often we do not turn to the all-seeing, all-knowing God first? Esther goes there first. She knew that she needed to get serious, because what she was about to do was a big deal. So she goes to God in prayer, and she seeks God's guidance. And then she says, I'm not just going to pray, we're going to ratchet our prayer up. We're going to fast. We're not going to eat or drink for 3 days. Now, fasting is an interesting spiritual discipline, because what it does is it heightens our awareness, causes us to focus in. And so that's why Esther says, let's fast and pray. She was listening for the voice of God. She wanted the guiding hand of the Holy Spirit. And she invited others to join her as they went to God first. Esther also teaches us this. You can overcome your fear by trusting in God more. One of the major reasons why you and I often do not step out of faith is because of something called fear. Fear comes in all shapes and sizes. I recently saw a list released by Yale University. A psychologist has done some research about our most prominent fears. Fear of commitment, fear of being alone, fear of trusting others, fear of speaking publicly, fear of commitment, and fear of failure. Often fear is an emotion prevalent in our lives. It controls us, it limits us, it enslaves us. And God doesn't want that from us. Now, Esther has lots to lose. She's got a lot on the line here. She lived in the royal palace for several years. She had become detached from what it was like to live as a regular citizen. She lives the good life. The world is at her disposal. She can have anything and everything she wants. But Esther initially tries to avoid becoming involved by sending word back to Mordecai, saying, I can't do this. If you go before the king and you have a Manasseh, I could die for that. At this point, then, we see a little glimpse of Esther's fear, don't we? And how we get the best of even her. But God doesn't want fear to rule our lives. God doesn't want us to be limited by our fears. You remember a while back I told you that that phrase, do not be afraid, it appears 365 times in the Bible, one for every day, to just remind you that every single day God does not want you to live in fear. And then Esther realizes that God is always at work. The book of Esther is unique. It's one of only two books in the Bible that never speak the name of God. God never appears at all in the scriptures. But do you think that means that God wasn't doing something? Of course not. God was at work. Even in the midst of our own lives, so often when we're not aware of what God's doing, God is still working. It's seen in our understanding of grace, isn't it? We believe in prevenient grace. Grace where God is at work even before we know who God is or what God can be up to. Even before we accept yes to God, God is already at work in our midst. Throughout the book of Esther, there's a series of providential events, or what I call simply holy coincidences. God, there are moments in Esther's story that God could only orchestrate. We need to be reminded that we are never alone, but that God is always embrace the opportunities that are set before us, and when we act on behalf of God. God never leaves us alone. There's a great Quaker historian. His name is Rufus Jones. He wrote a tremendous amount. He tells a story about an incident that happened in his childhood, a moment that charted the course of the rest of his life into becoming the great man that he became. It was his divine moment. Here's what he writes. One day, my parents told me to stay home and weed the turnip patch while they were gone. I had been with some friends who came by, and they persuaded me to go fishing with them, promising that they would help me weed the garden when we got back. But as every fisherman knows, it's practically impossible to keep track of time while you are fishing, especially if the fish are biting. So when Rufus finally returns home, it's dark, his friends are nowhere to be seen, and his mother is waiting on the front porch. He said, silently, she walked me up to my room. I knew what I deserved, so I did not offer any word of excuse. But then, he writes, a miracle happened instead. My mother sat me down in a chair. She knelt down on the floor, she put her hands on my head, and she told God all about me. She shared her dreams of what my life would be. She portrayed the boy and the man of her hopes. She told God what she always expected of me, and then how I had disappointed her. Oh God, she prayed, take this boy of mine and make him the boy and the man you have divinely designed him to be. And then she spoke that word, amen. He said, then she bent over, kissed me on the forehead, and left my room, and there I sat in the silence with God. He said, it was my divine moment. What about you? Are you ready to be used by God? Are you ready to be a hero or a shero of the faith? Is this your divine moment? Has God placed you in a particular place and in this time with particular people for such a time as this? May we all learn from these great, fierce women of the Bible, who took God's call seriously and who responded with their very lives. Let's pray again. Gracious and holy God, we thank you for the moment that you have placed before us. We thank you, God, that each of us has been given this time to gather together. May we seize every moment as that divine opportunity placed before us. We thank you, Lord, for the ways in which you are at work in us and through us. Help us, God, to be your people in every way. Let us never fear anything. And this is your Son's holy and blessed name we pray. Amen.
Amen. If you'll stand as we close in song, Jesus Christ. Go ahead.
On the night in which Christ was betrayed, he gathered together with his friends and they shared the holy meal. And that night, Jesus took the bread and he raised it to heaven and thanked God for the gift. Took it, broke it, and then shared it with his friends. Take and eat, all of you. This is my body, which is given for you. And every time you taste it, remember me. And then when the supper was just about over, Jesus took the last cup of the evening again. He raised it to heaven and thanked God for the gift. Took it and shared it with his friends. Drink from this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. So every time you taste it, remember me. Let's pray. Gracious God, we invite your Holy Spirit to be present here with us. We ask, God, that you would pour out on us and on these gifts of bread and juice your Holy Spirit, that they might become for us the very body and the blood of Christ, that we might be the body of Christ for the world. Make us one with you and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes again and we feast at his heavenly banquet. All glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forevermore. Amen. If you're in our sanctuary, I'm going to take that little cup. You'll see if you peel off that top layer, you're going to see a small little wafer. Do that first. We're going to share all that together. We're going to share together. So if you can get those wafers out.
Stand again and sing in the closing song, Jesus Messiah. Yes.
So, now, head up in your eyes open to enjoy this blessing. Go forth into the world and love God who made you and all that you do. And bear witness to the love of Christ in this life. So those who have known it, might find within you a warm and a generous friend. And may the love of God and the peace of Christ and the communion of God's Holy Spirit be with us today, tomorrow, and tomorrow.